There she is. Yeah.
Sorry, I was thinking if they could turn the music down, but he says it's as low as it goes right now.
It is. It's one of those unfortunate things. It comes with the territory here. But come on, Catherine.
Last week I'd asked Catherine to speak, and unfortunately we ran out of time. So with that, I was going to bring you on up and give the floor to you. Take like 10 or 15 minutes to talk about things. Obviously, how sophisticated you were involved with, and the outcome is a surprise to some, not a surprise to others. And you've obviously remained engaged, and as I understand things, have indicated your intent to knock on that door again. Is that right?
Nothing necessarily official, but we're certainly looking at the best way to get House District.
All right, so I give you Catherine Bedard.
Thank you so much, boss.
And you move up a little bit up here just so that they can hear you back there. And
come on this way, Catherine, so we can hear you.
Well, yes.
And don't let him throw anything at you.
Okay. I'll try not to. Anybody bring vegetables or anything like that? All right, everybody. So thank you for the introduction, Bob. I'm Catherine Bernard. I actually came and spoke to y'all earlier this spring before the House District 80 race had officially started, when we had just heard the word that Mike Jacobs was going to be appointed to a judgeship and we would have an open seat in House District 80. And that indeed happened. The governor called a special election the day after House leadership elections on May 12th. And I did announce the same day for House District 80. Actually, a few days later, the mayor of Brookhaven then announced. But he didn't step down as mayor. He just announced that he was planning to run and that he would step down during qualifying, which left us in a kind of an interesting situation for a couple of weeks in Brookhaven, where we had a sitting mayor campaigning for state representative even from the dais at a city council meeting. So that was an interesting perspective. So we had a couple of weeks there where things were a little up in the air. But after qualifying, it turned out there were three Republicans and one Democrat in the race. And you know, this was not a primary. Some people have been referring to the special election as a primary, but the July 14th election was a special election. So there was not necessarily going to be a runoff, but with four people in the race, it was pretty likely. So we did end up with three Republicans in the race: myself, J. Max Davis, the former mayor of Brookhaven, and then a gentleman named Lauren Collins, who actually an interesting fellow, really went to law school right after Mike Jacobs had followed his career, and that was what motivated him to run. He knew Mike Jacobs and heard about the open seat. So we had three Republicans in the race, had an interesting campaign, lots of mailers, the usual, and I did end up coming up short by 56 votes. We had a real heartbreaker for the campaign. So Taylor Bennett, the Democrat, came in with, I believe, 1472, which surprised a lot of folks. They didn't realize the Democrats had been making such an active play for House District 80. But one thing I want people to remember is that because Mike Jacobs had been elected as a Democrat and then switched over to a Republican and was very well liked in the district, that was kind of masking a bit of a purple shift that was happening in House District 80 that some of us noticed in Brookhaven, particularly the southern parts of Brookhaven, you know, districts 2, 3, and 4 that are, you know, historic Brookhaven, south of Peachtree, the more urban, younger areas versus the parts up towards Dunwoody in the north. So a lot of us were aware of this trend, you know, that the Democrats were making a play in House District 80. And they really put a lot of resources in from the House caucus level. Their candidate, Taylor Bennett, didn't have any experience in the community, and that was in fact why some of the Democrats were reluctant to support him, because of his lack of experience. They thought that, you know, that it would be better to have somebody who had a record of, you know, ethics reform in Brookhaven. But he did end up, you know, sending out a lot of paid canvassers, getting a lot of votes, and came in first. Then we had that 56 vote split between myself and J. Max Davis. And now, you know, J. Max and I have known each other for a couple of years now. You know, I started going to city council meetings as soon as my husband and I moved to Brookhaven. And we've been involved in a couple of different legislative issues. You know, there was an opportunity zone tax credit that he was seeking to get for our city. You know, I read through it and I had some concerns. You know, it says opportunity zone tax credit, but really you end up having to pay a lobbying firm about $120,000 to get the federal government to declare your area as blighted. So just because you're going to end up with a $3,500 tax credit, it's a little bit, you know, nerve-wracking to think about getting that kind of federal government involvement at the city level. And I think that's what a lot of us have worried about with the addition of city government. So I'd also interacted with him on some, the mayor, on some litigation that Brookhaven has been involved in. I've been consistently concerned that Brookhaven has been spending too much on lawyers, and I am a lawyer, so I can recognize when you've got a lot of folks working on things. So there have definitely been some issues throughout the tenure of his mayorship that we had differed on. The main one being the redevelopment powers law, which he, along with Mike Jacobs, had tried to get on the ballot in Brookhaven, and that's something that would have expanded debt and eminent domain powers, so a real problem from a small government perspective. I chaired the committee to defeat that redevelopment powers law, which was actually very successful. We were proud of that. And that's one of the things that we had tried to build on during the campaign, was people who wanted transparency, people who wanted accountability. And we built a pretty cool bipartisan coalition, with the eye too beating a Democrat, because we don't want to have the Democrats come in and say, you've got your ethics reform, but we'll be raising your taxes and increasing the regulations on your businesses along the way. That's not the kind of ethics reform that anybody wants. So I've been really trying to push a conservative vision of ethics reform, where we look at how we can reduce the tax burden on individuals, where we look at how we can reduce government involvement in people's lives. And I think that's a vision that, we're getting some traction on in Brookhaven. However, we did have a lot of support from leadership, for my opponent, that he did get a lot more donations than I did from folks in the House and Senate. And, I'm not going to say that was a factor. There's certainly other things. I had, two big trials going on during that special election period. So there's all sorts of factors. You can't blame any one thing. But we did end up with J-Max in the runoff. It was a tough runoff. Some of the issues that had been coming up before that I actually kind of alluded to the first time I spoke to y'all, that we had some scandals in the AJC. I didn't run on that. I didn't run a negative campaign. I didn't go around trying to bash anyone, because that just, tears at the fabric of our community in Brookhaven. J-Max was from Brookhaven. His family was from Brookhaven. There's no need to tear somebody down. You want to just offer something more positive. But things did get pretty ugly between him and the Democrat, and I think that was a big factor in a very substantial loss. It was a 500 vote difference, so it was not even close. And this is a district that has been specifically designed to be Republican leaning, with the removal of the Togo Hills area and the addition of Sandy Springs. It went for Romney about 54%, so we were looking for it to be a Republican district, but a 29-year-old Democrat won by a substantial margin. So I'm looking at this as, this is a disappointment for me, because I am now being represented by someone whose chief claim to fame is being a quarterback for Georgia Tech, which my husband did go to Georgia Tech, so there are worse qualifications, certainly. But I'm really nervous about what he has expressed as his vision of big government. He's part of the millennial generation, and I'm actually the oldest millennial at 33, apparently, but he's 29, and his motivation to get into this race was RFRA. He said that when he heard about RFRA, he said that if it passed, that his gay mother would not be able to go to Starbucks because they would want to not let gay people in. And now I am a passionate advocate of equal rights for all. And in fact, my aunt is also gay, and I would never condone any discrimination against anyone. But for him to make that claim that RFRA was going to cause Starbucks to not let gay people in, that to me just bespeaks a very deep misunderstanding of the way that regulations affect our lives and the way that RFRA was intended. I didn't like the way it was written, and Josh McCoon is actually coming to speak to the DeKalb Young Republicans in September on this. I think the language could be cleaned up. But I think this is a real example of how progressives, even though they are often preaching enlightenment and tolerance, they are looking to do it by forcing more government regulations on people. And I just, I know most of the folks in this room are already on the same page, but that's a real worry that we have, interacting with these independents and Democrats in Brookhaven, that, they're wonderful people, so well motivated, they want equal rights for all, but they're looking to the state to get it. And that's a really dangerous situation, and that's why I think Taylor Bennett is so dangerous. He talks a great game on ethics reform, accountability, but he doesn't have the experience to see the actual places where your ethics get challenged, and he has a vision of a very expansive state role. So I think we've got to get rid of him. This is only a one legislative session term. He'll be up for election in November 2016. Hopefully this will be a session where they can't do much damage in terms of raising taxes and otherwise increasing the role of government. And hey, who knows? We've had a Democrat switch to Republican before in this district, so anything's possible. I'm just looking for how we can turn this back to some conservative control. But the thought that I would like to leave folks with is that this is a real example of how conservative thoughts and principles have to evolve in the 21st century in order to, I don't want to say stay relevant, because they'll always be relevant, but in order to retain and continue appealing to new people. We can't be a party, we can't be a conservative movement of people who don't seem open to new ideas, who don't seem open to new people, who don't seem welcoming. We want to be welcoming to everyone, just, you know, recognizing that we would like to welcome you to, you know, not take all of our money and control our lives through a government that ends up, you know, being pretty corrupt on a lot of levels, as we see in DeKalb. And that actually provides a really great opportunity for us, you know, being in DeKalb. Because even the Democrats see, you know, this is just ridiculous what we're looking at. You know, we are looking at corruption that, you know, has become almost a punchline. You know, it's like, what's the newest line? We even get, you know, great folks like Nancy Jester elected to the commission, and, you know, we still see things like Lee May actually filming an announcement video for that stadium deal 2 days before the county commission vote. He filmed a video, like a professionally shot video, announcing, we have this wonderful new stadium deal. That was before the vote was taken. That, to me, is a dangerous sign for the health of our fundamental republic. And so I see House District 80 as a great place to really take that back, to show that conservatives have the ethics reform, have the economic opportunity, have really the principles and values that will cause us all to be happier, healthier, and more prosperous. So that's the message that I'm going to be taking forward, and it does look like I probably will be running for House District 80 again. And this time, you know, I've learned a lot. I used to be a little bit shy about reaching out and asking for money because I thought, oh, you know, politics, it's almost a little embarrassing because you see so much corruption when you talk to your friends about it. But this has really energized a lot of people, seeing what happened, seeing that we've got a session with someone who explicitly believes in big government. So we've got a lot of work to do. I'm ready to start on that work. We're continuing with this coalition, and I really appreciate, you know, getting the chance to be here and be a part of this forum. So happy to answer any questions, either now or afterwards.
Let me I'll start. If one of the questions that came up during the runoff was, why are you not engaged in supporting Republican nominee, being that you're one of the Republicans in the election? So, and I think you've answered it, but I don't know that everybody has heard your answer, so today may be a good chance to articulate that.
Absolutely. You know, I did not endorse J-Max, and he did ask for my endorsement. I want to emphasize, you know, he actually did come to my victory party, and, you know, we went to lunch with him and his campaign manager. You know, he did reach out, and I do appreciate his efforts, and I do think that, you know, he's looking to be a good conservative like his dad. But ultimately, I was too concerned with the record that he had built up in Brookhaven. And again, I'm not talking about things that, you know, other people had told me. I'm talking about direct conversations and interactions, you know, at the government level. I was very concerned that his perception of his philosophy of government allowed for a lot of control, even though it was called free market. And the Opportunity Zone tax credit that I just mentioned is kind of an example of that. You know, J-Max was a big supporter of that, and the fact that we couldn't get on the same page about recognizing how problematic it was for the federal government to come in and declare, you know, the area around the MARTA station, which includes my house, as blighted, the fact that he couldn't understand the danger of it really made me think that we need to work on that understanding of being conservative. I'll also tell you, quite frankly, this outcome was not a surprise to me or anyone else who was knocking on doors. The scandals that were associated with Brookhaven, you know, the Lysol spraying was unfortunately only the tip of the iceberg. There was a cronyism investigation where a contract was improperly given to his father-in-law. There were contracts improperly given to people on the planning commission. There were multiple allegations of behavior that can be described as retaliation. And, you know, these are not things that I am happy to have to say. And, people have told me that I should have talked about it more during the special election. And maybe I should have, because I think a lot of the people, you know, a lot of the people who voted for him would not have done so if they understood how weak he was against this Democrat. But I knew that he had so damaged his reputation in Brookhaven that I was not going to be able to save him. I was only going to be able to further drag down the work that we had done as conservatives and Republicans in the district. So it was a hard decision. I didn't announce it till the day before the election. But I know that it was not me that caused the loss, because we had the governor and the secretary of state. We had elected officials knocking on doors. There was a lot of Republican push, but the answer from House District 80 was, you know, if this is a Republican, then it's not what we're looking for. And that's the unfortunate situation we're in. So thank you for the opportunity.
Any other questions? All right, thank you, Catherine.
Thank you so much. Thank you.